What do you do for a living?
I am a professor at Princeton.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, they trick you into doing this.
This is the Redneck Fishing Competition, an event that's quintessentially American, centered around a fish that's definitely not.
We're official. We're in it. In it to win it. For the land
and the and the heart. My guide is Lance Gregerson, a local fisherman.
And we're off. Off like a herd of turtles.
Do you consider yourself a redneck?
Hell yeah.
You proud to be a redneck?
Yeah.
Okay.
The goal here is simple. Catch as many carp as possible in mid-air. You see, when the carp hear a boat, they launch themselves right out of the water. So you could be cruising along, minding your own business, and wind up like this.
Oh, that was a beamer.
I've been commercial fishing since I was about 14 years old. We're a catfish and a few other normal species that we have around here until the carp showed up.
Yeah.
That changed everything.
When these became more abundant, what was it like for the local fishermen?
There was nothing anybody could do with them because they're just a pain in the butt to clean.
In the U.S., we like our fish with as few bones as possible, making the bony Asian carp hard to sell as food. Without a market, carp have overrun these waterways and transformed the lives of people who work and play in the river. But as always, people adapted.
Good shot.
Hell of a good time.
The tournament's become an annual ritual, but it won't even make a dent in the carp population. Asian carp reproduce quicker, grow faster, and generally outcompete every other fish in the river. Today, they make up 60 to 70% of the Illinois River's biomass. But how did this fish jump across the Pacific and land here in the first place?
Hey, Andrew, what's happening, man?
Not too much. How you doing?
Just went to a redneck fishing tournament, got smacked in the face by a carp.
Andrew Reeves is a Canadian journalist who spent 10 years learning to ride a bike. Oh, wait, I've read that wrong. He spent 10 years writing a book about Asian carp.
We have this umbrella term of Asian carp, but it really doesn't do the individual species justice.
Four species were imported from Asia to American waters: black, grass, bighead, and silver carp.
They were perhaps one of the last invasive species that were actually like brought over with the full-throated support of government and the scientific community.
Each species was brought here with a specific job to do. And let's just say the silver carp drew the short straw.
You can't just dump solid waste into your local waterway anymore. You can use these fish to be able to clean up those sewage lagoons.
Just so I'm clear, they wanted to use the carp to eat human waste.
That's right. And around that time, someone also had the idea of, could we also eat them if they're eating nothing but like human waste?
Nobody wants to eat poop fish.
No, and this was it. And so they've kind of had this like trash fish reputation.
If the carp had just stayed in their sewage lagoons, we might not be having this conversation. But politics gave the fish an unexpected opportunity.
I would like to have a crusade today, and it would be one to take government off the backs of the great people of this country.
Ronald Reagan slashed the number of regulations that the EPA could enforce, and essentially all the research that was being done on silver and bighead just evaporated overnight. All of a sudden, they had tens of thousands of fish and nothing to do with them. So some people essentially opened the sluice gates on their properties, and we're still suffering the consequences of that today.
In just a few decades, carp had spread through the Mississippi River and most of its tributaries. Today, the front lines of the war on carp are just south of Chicago.
Well, what does the fish say when it runs into something in the river? Damn!
I met Scott Whitney at the Brandon Road Lock and Dam. Scott isn't just a purveyor of bad puns. He's also been fighting invasive species for decades with the Army Corps of Engineers. Scott's marching orders: use whatever means necessary to stop the carp from entering the Great Lakes, where scientists worry their impact could be catastrophic.
We have one chance to stop that movement at this point.
The Great Lakes wouldn't be at risk if carp were just spreading up the historic Illinois River. The problem is, we've re-engineered the river, connecting it with Lake Michigan through a massive system of canals and locks. Now, thanks to us, the Great Lakes are connected to the Mississippi River and its tributaries, all the way to the Gulf of Mexico. Before Scott and his team build any carp barriers in the real world, they have to test them in the lab.
We have a series of technologies, sound, bubbles, electricity, and a flushing lock.
Like they're literally running a gauntlet.
None of which by itself is 100% guaranteed, but layering them together provides a variety of challenges to overcome. They have a unique characteristic between their air bladder and their inner ear. I call it the echo chamber. That sound is amplified into their inner ear in a way that causes them to leap out of the water. You know, they react to noise.
Like, say, the noise of an outboard motor at a one-of-a-kind fishing tournament.
How much did it cost to build the infrastructure?
This particular project has about an $800 million price tag. Ooh. Right now. It's a tall order, but the investment right now is the least costly it's ever going to be. It's only going to get bigger from here on.
Time will tell if Scott and his team can keep Asian carp out of the Great Lakes. But in many American waters, they're already a fact of life. So we're getting creative, hence the Redneck Fishing Tournament. These fish are gonna be turned into fertilizer. But the state of Illinois hasn't given up on carp as food. As they like to say, if you can't beat them, eat them.
The new name for Asian carp is Copi. That's C-O-P-I. It's short for copious, which is exactly what this fish is.
To test the waters, Illinois is cooking up carp, I mean copi, for one population that's always hungry, college students.
You should do the hard part. I want to show you up on TV, so you do the hard part.
Even the hard part, I have a hard time too, so.
This is Chef Soowha Yu. He's got a green thumb, and he's a magician in the kitchen, transforming carp into something folks here on campus actually like to eat.
I could show you how to play this one.
Okay.
So you gotta be careful, there's some bones right here. It's a really heavy bone right here. You gotta.
Okay, so you're working around the bone. Yeah, that's a thick bone. Yeah. Jeez.
It's a really hard bone right there. Uh-huh. Then you follow the bone, and you're going to hear this. One, two. That's a bone.
Chef Yu really knows his way around those bones.
There you go.
Oh, wow. I've been hearing, like, people talk about how bony the fish is.
Chef Yu has been busy for over half a decade finding tasty ways to serve this fish.
And this is like a fried copi, a little savory and salty. Oops. And there's spoon there, just make sure.
Okay. Oh, it smells delicious.
That's why I'm in diet, so I have a smaller piece. Dig in. Let's see. So make sure you don't see any bones on it.
Oh, that's good. It's succulent. Yeah, you definitely gotta make your way around the bones though, I see.
See, normally the Asian, what we do, just eat the whole fish in the mouth.
Okay.
And you just move around.
Mm-hmm. And then you work through it.
Like this.
Okay. You can't be uppity with somebody pulling bones out of your mouth.
Yeah.
Carp have been a staple of East Asian cuisine for centuries. And I can taste why. It's hard to believe Americans haven't embraced this fish and that little bit of extra work it takes to enjoy it.
We're in the Midwest. We're meat and potato guys. But now we have a lot of fish out there, so we have to eat it up.
Oh nice save! Nice save!
Invasive species like carp are a problem. Don't get me wrong, but they're here to stay. And it seems to me there's a solution staring us in the face. But somehow, we just can't be bothered to pull a few bones out of our teeth. So instead, we're stuck spending almost $1 billion on a technological solution to a very human problem.